Welcome to Cook Optics TV. Today we are interviewing Lachlan Milne for his work on Minari.
Yeah, if you haven't seen the film yet, you've got to go and watch it straight away because it's got this lovely, homely, heartwarming feel to it. And you see this family who are settling in America and you see their life unfold. And it is just a beautiful film to watch.
Enjoy the interview. We watched the film the other day and
it's lovely, isn't it? It's such a lovely
film. It is so lovely. From the first 5 minutes you're watching it, you have a smile on your face, you love this family, all the dynamics and everything that you have. You dive straight into it.
David, look, they're wheels.
Wheels?
여기 대체 어디야?
집이지.
우리 새로 시작한다고 그랬잖아. 이게 그거야.
Everybody that I speak to about that film that enjoys it has a similar story. Like, it seems incredibly relatable to everybody on a lot of different levels, which is what I love about it. You don't want anything bad to happen to this family, because even though they're going through a difficult period, everybody's in it for the right reasons. At the end of the day, family is the most important thing. And particularly given the climate that we've all lived through for the last 12 months, it's such a wonderful reaffirming message in a time when lots of people probably are looking for a little bit of that as well, right?
It'd be great to ask you just about how you even got involved with the project in the first place. You know, I mean, you're wrapping up on a project in Queensland.
Yes.
And you got a call from your agent. That's a crazy story in itself, right?
It's a crazy story.
Yeah.
It's funny, you know, I broke the cardinal rule of, you know, never answering a telephone call during a shot. And because I always operate a camera, I literally had to stop. Guys, just give me a second there, because my agent Grant had set up a meeting, assuming that I would love the script as much as he did, which I did. So he said, and I've mentioned this a couple of times, he's like, Lachlan, don't go to any rap parties, don't go out to dinner, don't do anything, just go straight home and read this fucking script. I remember he was saying it to me on the phone. I'm like, oh, okay, sure. And then I went home and I went, this is amazing. This is something I've been waiting for such a long time, especially off the back of doing these you know, bigger budget, spectacle kind of projects. I come from independent films, you know, that's where I started, and I love the purity and the creative control you get on projects of something like that. And just the script was so heartfelt and genuine and wonderful. There wasn't anything technical about the execution of the film, which I know it sounds silly, but that's something that I loved. I love the simplicity of the script, and I don't mean that in any negative way whatsoever. I just love that it was just a simple story that didn't rely on the technical components of filmmaking sometimes that other projects can do. And I just love the purity of that. So I went home, read it, loved it, spoke to Isaac the next day. Turns out I was the first DP that he'd spoken to from the get-go. I mean, I instantly liked him. He's such a wonderful human. Like, he's so much of the reason why I think that film is so honest and great is because it just reflects the kind of person that he is. He was a real crossroads when he decided to write that film and then eventually get it made, because he was that was his fourth film, and he's 42, and he's like, I don't know if this is really good. I don't know if it's my thing. I'm not sure if this is how it's supposed to pan out, you know. So he was borderline, it was a real sliding doors moment for him. He almost gave the game away. But instead, he made a 6-time Academy Award-winning movie.
Yeah. Start small. I mean, you know, how did that work? Because obviously, it's such a personal film for him. Obviously, being a Korean American, but then, you know, he's grown up on a farm in Arkansas, and you know, how did that? I mean, did he draw from his personal experiences? And you know, how did you bear that in mind when considering how to shoot the film?
It's quite an accelerated pre-production. We only had 4 weeks together, but those 4 weeks were literally him and I sitting like how you guys are sitting at the moment for 4 weeks. And we just break down each scene and work out who's seen it, which I love. I love that part about pre-production. I said, do you want this to be like a series of memories, or, you know, because I thought that maybe there's an interesting way that we could approach that photographically as well. There are definite Polaroid moments that he's pulled out from his childhood memory that are in the film 100%, but it's not strictly autobiographical. Like, I don't remember much about growing up at my grandma's house, but I remember, you know, smells, or I remember curtains, but I don't remember specific occurrences, if that makes sense. So that for me is like a little, I tried to kind of think about how we might shoot certain things with that concept in mind, because, you know, the clarity of memory as a 6-year-old, once you get to 30, 40, 50, you know, a lot of that stuff gets pushed out to make room for newer memories. And so you just have tiny little, little bite-sized pieces of memory from those periods.
That's one thing that I really loved about the film, is from the get-go, it's about family. It reminds me of my family. It reminds me of other people's families.
아이고, 스트롱, 스트롱 보이. 스트롱 보이. 왜? 이런 소리 처음 들어봤어? 데이비사, 너는 스트롱 보이야. 할머니가 본 사람 중에서 제일 스트롱 보이야.
You made the caravan look homely. It felt spacious. Almost like when you're a child and you remember things and everything looks, seems bigger. And I think your approach to bringing that family feel was such an important aspect, and you did that really well. What was your approach to that and how you brought that homely feel to, I guess, their home?
In a film like that, it's very easy to lean into a lot of stereotypes. Like if you think about the way that racism is treated in the film, it's more of like a confusion or a misunderstanding rather than like a hatred or an anger or something like that, you know, like which the temptation to do that, especially mid-80s in, you know, middle America would be very easy to lean into. And it was the same attitude that we had when we were talking about the home. It's like the family have such a sense of pride and self-worth, and they take pride in how they, you know, put their photographs there. They get some nice lampshades. It's always clean. You know, they put some artwork on the wall. So that was something that we wanted to put in there to say that, you know, this is them making the best version of this for themselves as they can. And when we shot it, I really wanted to rely on practical lighting as much as possible, because I wanted to shoot as wide as I could in what was a small trailer, for the same reason that you mentioned, Bippin, as well, about wanting it to feel bigger, particularly from a child's perspective, because it was very small, but primarily to try and get as many of the cast into one frame as possible to limit the amount of coverage so that we would play it more as an ensemble piece. And I didn't want to light from the ceiling, because for me, when you light from the ceiling, it always feels like a studio. So, you know, I'd hide things behind practical lights, or I'd dress LED underneath parts of the kitchen so I could just pick out little areas, you know, particularly for the nighttime stuff, or obviously light through windows for daytime scenes.
Was it a studio? Was it a built set?
I come off a couple of projects where it's like, you just build everything. So I was reading, I was like, oh, clearly we'll build this on stage because of the amount of the sheer volume of work that would go down in there. But it was a very modest budget film. And so the trailer, the exterior trailer that you see on location is the interior trailer.
Oh, wow.
So we shot everything there.
It feels like it's shot on a full frame camera. And then I was quite surprised to know that it wasn't. It was a, you know, Alexa Mini, and it feels like that. You've got the depth and you've got the width.
Like I use the P Vintage lenses, which I've done a couple of films with now. And one of the reasons I did that is because they have a 29 millimeter lens in there, which is a very unusual focal length. I felt like most of the film was going to fit between like 24 and 35 mil. And I wanted to get a set of lenses that had a few within that range. And honestly, 80% of the time we were shooting in the trailer, it was on the 29 mil. Maybe sometimes I go to a 35 for some close-up stuff, but I didn't want it to be close. Like we had this thing where we wanted to earn close-ups within scenes, you know, and we'd only use it to put you know, to highlight a particular tonal moment, or a, you know, somebody's making a decision or an argument or something like that, something where it was important to make the actor larger in frame.
I love
but
that.
Most of the time we were really restrained with that, and we went as wide as we possibly could, just primarily just to fit as much of this wonderful cast in the frame as we could.
I thought the lighting for the whole film in general felt very nostalgic, yet very naturalistic at the same time. And yeah, I didn't see one shot when I thought, oh, they're using a light there, and you know, or it felt.
It was really important to me to try and make it feel like that. So I'm glad you thought that.
The film's shot in relatively in static shots as well, and where you let the performances of the actors essentially just speak for themselves, with almost like an Ozu quality to some of the dialogue scenes.
Ozu was definitely a reference that we spoke about a lot, you know, who's a fantastic filmmaker, but, you know, Koreeda, Lee Chang-dong, or Terrence Malick, obviously, just in the way that they use the camera as a storytelling tool, you know, and not relying on dialogue and exposition all the time, you know, deliberately moving it or not moving it from a story motivated point of view. I find that fascinating, and I love that. And I think that you can do things in a really subtle way that the audience aren't really aware of, but they get something out of it that is considered, you know, which I really like.
There's some really, really nice shots in there where you just focus on like particles of dust on the bed sheet, for example, or, you know, or like, you know, smoking outside in the field, which, you know, I've read about now, and, you know, it's beautiful, beautiful moments. I mean, do you just catch these moments on the fly?
I'm a huge fan of developing a textural library of things like that. And, you know, like the dust on the bed was in between takes with Alan, as he was waking up one morning with, you know, David, the character. when he woke up, when he wet the bed, and I just had a light come, one light coming through the window, and then the art department would redress the bed. You know, he'd get out and he'd change, and then he'd come back and they dressed it, and you know, there just happened to be a bit of dust on it, and I just panned from that, and I was, because it was right next to me. I was here, and it was right next to me on the window. I just panned across to that and went minimum focus, and then saw all that stuff coming through. So it's just little found bits like that, and there are plenty of opportunities throughout making a film where you're waiting on something, but things like that happen to be right next to you that you just discover. Stephen smoking in the field thing was a byproduct of me going out and shooting a sunset shot. He came out and he was just having a cigarette behind me, and I was rolling. I had a 17.5mm lens on, and I looked over my shoulder and he was there. So I just kept rolling, pulled the camera off. It was this great image because, you know, it was a big day. Everybody was a bit tired. It was really hot, you know, so there was like a fatigue element of the film making process, which at that point was perfect for him. And the part that Isaac used it in the film is wonderful because he's at this real crossroads. And there's no dialogue, there's no explanation of anything. It's just one guy in the middle of a field who's, you know, exhausted and is reevaluating whether or not the decisions he's made for him and his family are going to pay off.
What is it about, you know, all the various shots that you did and in the conversations that you had with everybody? Why is it that I feel when I'm watching it that I'm there with them and I can see it unfolding?
I had a bit of a mantra in my head going on all the time, which was just be honest and don't influence anything. Like, don't get in the way of all this. That's why when I told you I was so excited to read a script that was simple, you know, in a nice way. It's like, it's not about the camera. It's not about the execution of the film, really. It's about what's in front of the camera. And I don't like to limit actors as to where they can stand with light or give them specific marks, especially when you're working with, you know, young talent, the kids. You just can't do that, or else they concentrate too much on that and then they screw up their performance because they're focusing on the wrong stuff. They're not just being a kid, you know. You got to let them be a six-year-old and adapt to what they're doing if you want to get the best performance out of them.
What's been your experiences or best practices towards working with younger actors? You've done this previously on Pump for the Wilder People, Stranger Things, and lots of other projects like that.
For some reason or another, I end up being the kid guy, and I don't know how that keeps happening.
They were great. Those two kids were just like, oh my God.
I mean, do you have a kind of a good practice towards working with younger actors and getting, obviously, you know, yourself and the director getting the best performances out of them?
I really pushed hard to operate on that film because there's a few tricks that you can do that makes them more comfortable and enables them to be better at their job. And and I approach like a methodology about how I wanted to do it. I knew that if I was able to do that, it would free him up in a way that maybe other people might not be able to do. I know that sounds a bit arrogant. I don't mean it like that at all. I just wanted it to be as liberating for him as possible. So that's part of the reason why I chose the Mini as well, because I didn't want to use any filtration. I wanted to use older lenses without having to use, you know, external NDs or low cons or diffusion or anything like that, because what it does, particularly with kids, is when you put a flat piece of glass in front of the lens, it turns it into a mirror. So all of a sudden, and it's you doing handheld close-up stuff, it's very easy for kids to get distracted because all of a sudden they catch a reflection of themselves and then all of a sudden they're looking at the camera, and that takes ruined. A lot of his close-up stuff handheld, but not to feel handheld, just so that I could react really quickly. If he would do something spontaneously, I could go with whatever it was that he was doing, and I wouldn't be limited by track or tripods or whatever it might be, you know. The style of shooting that, say, like the Duffer brothers use for Stranger Things is incredibly different to something like Isaac for Minari, you know. Stranger Things is all about dollies and techno cranes and multiple cameras and all that sort of stuff, and it's a lot more about the execution. So within that, there are a lot of limitations that we tend to put on these actors, but they're all quite seasoned now.
I was just amazed that the budget for the film was about $2 million. I think more than anything, it's just really inspirational for filmmakers around the world to know that you can craft such a well-executed story with that kind of budget. Was the absence of a bigger budget a good thing or a bad thing? And how did you find it working with that?
I think the $2 million version of this film is the best version of this film. I think that if this was a $15 million film, it would have become something completely different. It would have been bigger. We would have more time. Maybe there's more characters in the film. Maybe we built the trailer and the trailer's completely different. And you know what I mean? All that stuff. But I think that the limitations of this project were its advantage. I think, you know, once you get into films like that, then you've got dollies every day and you've got cranes every other day and all that stuff. And all of a sudden you're building in shots that facilitate that kind of a budget that don't, for me anyway, for that film, I think the smallest version of that film was the best.
I'm wondering if there's something, I guess, you could share with anybody that we might be watching this video as, you know, who are making films, who are training to be a filmmaker? Is there something that you would sort of share from this film, the things that you might have learned?
The key is to go into the situation with your eyes open and know your limitations. And don't throw your toys out of the pram when you can't get a crane every day. You know, you can't just assume because it's a film that you will get access to a lot of that stuff, particularly in the independent world. You don't always need that in order to make it a big film. You know, like if you take things like Hunt for the Wilder People, I think that was 3 million New Zealand.
I'll never stop running.
Yeah, and I'll never stop chasing you. I'm relentless. I'm like the Terminator.
I'm more like Terminator than you.
I said it first, you're more like Sarah Connor in the first movie too, before she could do chin-ups.
We shot for 25 days, same as Minari. It was a 25-day shoot. We had a child actor, minor actor, who had very limited hours. We had to service the whole film within 45 minutes drive of Auckland, the, you know, the big city on the North Island, so that the local crew, they didn't have to be accommodated, all that sort of stuff. I always have a plan A and a plan B for everything. Filmmaking is, to a certain degree, problem solving. Everybody goes in there with a plan, but then it pours with rain, or you lose the location 2 days before, or an actor gets sick. Don't wish for things that you know are impossible. Work within your limitations and be smart and think laterally and get like-minded people on board, and then empower people, hopefully, that are better than you at their jobs to do their job. Everybody's work is better if you're in an environment where everybody feels like they can suggest something without fear of reprisal or, you know, getting laughed at or something like that. You know, a good idea is a good idea, and it doesn't matter where it comes from.
I felt like that's what you had, you know, as a crew on this film. You know, I guess you could only get that really nice warm feeling is because you guys as crew members and everybody working together worked really well together.
Yes. When the Academy Awards came out the other day, I was shooting, and so I was on set shooting, but I had my laptop live streaming, seeing what was going down at the same time. And then Isaac sent me this text message saying, there's a Zoom call at 8 p.m. And I went, fantastic. I thought it'd be, you know, like a handful of people. It'd be maybe me and Isaac and Christina, the producer, Stephen, YJ, you know, a couple of the actors, etc. So then I go and I race home. I was a little bit late, and I log in, and there's 52 people on the Zoom call.
Wow. That's brilliant. So
and that's between four countries. There's, I don't know, however many cities, you know, it was like all the cast, almost all the Oklahoma crew. And it was that for me. And I said that as I signed off, because I had to go and prep the next day. I said, this is like an example of how much this film meant to everybody, and about everybody doing this film for the right reasons. And it's so lovely that everybody took the time to come together for one last time to celebrate this as a group of filmmakers. You know, I think one of the real keys as to why people get so much out of that film as well, because there was such an investment from so many different people into that project.
It was such a nice respite just to watch something and actually have a smile and like get taken under, and then by the end of it you're just like, oh. They're burning the barn, man, like, you know, what's going on? But then it kind of comes through, and then it's just, you know, you're smiling by the end.
My heart was in my mouth for that scene as well. It's just like, don't, you can't, you just can't do this.
It's the ambiguity of it as well, because David's running after the grandma. You're like, what is happening in this scene? She's just going to like die in the middle of the street now?
Is he going to have a heart attack or something? Because we know he's got a condition. It's like all these things, you're like, please don't do this.
You just remind me of something that I don't think I even told Isaac this, and I've forgotten until literally right now, is that when I got the script, early on in the pages, you read that, you know, David has an undiagnosed health issue. And I'm like, this fucking kid better not die. So I went to the end of the script and read the end of it to make sure that he didn't. And turns out that he didn't. And so then, okay, cool. All right. I'll continue reading it, because I'm like, I don't know if I can make a film about a child dying right now.
It's a Korean film, Korean language mostly. How did that limitation work for you in terms of not understanding the language that's being spoken, but also maybe not even understanding the language that you're overhearing?
All of the Korean actors spoke English with varying degrees of ability, I guess. What I didn't give enough consideration to, because I was also the operator, right? What I didn't give enough consideration to was I'd only ever read the script in English. And then we started shooting, and I was like, and all in the script, it always said in Korean, but they would have the English version. I'm like, yeah, sure, that'd be fine. And then we started shooting, and everything's in Korean. I'm like, huh. Yeah. So remember, there's a shot between Monica and Jacob having an argument in as a 50-50, and it's panning between the two of them. She's in the kitchen and he's in the dining room. That was early on in the shoot, and I remember thinking, I don't quite know when to pan. So then what I would do is I'd speak to Yeri and Stephen and Isaac and Stephanie, who was a wonderful interpreter on the project as well, about I'd listen for certain words to motivate when that was about to finish. But the really interesting thing for me about operating a film in a language that you didn't speak was how much you lean on instincts and the physicalities of performance to motivate when you move things.
Because I guess if you don't understand what they're saying, you might pick up the emotion more, or you might pick up something else, the body language or something.
A lot of the time, what you don't necessarily read in scripts is the time between words. There was one, it's that same scene that I was telling you about where I went in. That was one scene where we wanted to do close-ups because, you know, the couple are reaching a breaking point. You know, this is quite an emotional moment. They're at a crossroads, et cetera. And when we did Yeri's performance, Monica, her single coverage, and she's amazing. I mean, she deserves so much credit for this film. I think she's phenomenal on that. I mean, everybody is. So, but there was this one moment where I realized how good an actor she was when I was operating her coverage for that. And there was a moment where she's yelling at Jacob, but she would stop and kind of compose herself. And you can see that she's fighting the urge not to say something as a character. And then she starts crying. And I remember there was this pause and I just started leaning towards her. And by the time, and then she felt me doing that. And then I stopped. And then she started performing again. And none of that was scripted or anything. You know, it was just like her picking up on what I was doing and me picking up on what she was doing in a really lovely, natural way.
And for you, that's purely on body language, energy, the emotion that you're feeling, not what they're saying. Yeah, that's great.
That's why it was so interesting for me as an operator to, you know, it's like, you know, people say that when you lose one sense, the other ones are heightened. You know, if you lose your eyesight, your hearing gets better, or, you know, it was a little bit like that. You know what I mean?
First time we've actually had that kind of experience shown from another cinematographer, so it's great to hear about that. I wish you all the best with the rest of Stranger Things as well, and I hope that goes really well. Thanks so much for your time today.
Yeah, I really appreciate it. It's been super fun.
That was Lachlan Milne for his work on Minari. I mean, inspirational, $2 million budget. Great crew, great cast. If you've not seen it, go and check it out.
Yeah, I love the film. Remember to like and subscribe. And we'll see you in the next Cacoptics TV episode.